Last, since nearly the beginning of the year, we've been going through the Gospel of Mark, and we ended up in the Jesus' death and resurrection last weekend. His great love for us, his resurrection life gives us hope for today, gives us hope for tomorrow. And this new series we're starting is called Stuck. And if I ask for a show of hands this morning, probably nearly all of us at one stage, or you may be stuck now, or we could put our hands up, that we go through situations, we go through life and things that don't make sense. And whether if you may have lost your job, you may have lost a loved one, maybe a breakdown in relationships in family, or even with friends, and maybe financial hardships, maybe different things that happen, and we find ourselves stuck when things don't make sense, and we're trying to figure out, God, what are you trying to say to me? What's your plans and purposes for my life? Things that we don't understand. I don't know if you've ever seen the film. I'm sure it's probably on Netflix, or you may have. There is a book, and it's called The Hiding Place, and it's the story of the life of Corrie Ten Boom, who, with her father, they were watchmakers in Holland, and with her sister. And during the time of the German war and the Nazi regime, and during this time they were hiding in their house, hundreds of families of Jewish people and hundreds of babies, they would hide in their house to try to be able to escape. And anyhow, they found out, their house is raided. And if you know the story, her father is taken off. She doesn't see him again. And she goes to a concentration camp at Ravensbrück with her sister Betsy. And they spend many years there in this concentration camp. One week before her sister would die, and all the other women in her dorm or hut or whatever you would call it, were all killed and executed, by some clerical error, she was released a week beforehand, and she tells that. And then after she'd been released and after the war is over, she goes everywhere bringing hope and talking about that hatred only locks us in a prison, but love and forgiveness frees us. And her nephew, Peter, who's 16, he's arrested and thrown into jail at 16 years of age because in all of this that's going on, he stood up and he didn't stand up. He sat at this organ and he played the Dutch national anthem as loud as he could, which was against the rules. And so they locked him up and threw him in prison. Years later now, they're both released and they travel throughout the world to bring hope to people with the same message of forgiveness is the only answer to hatred. Even some of the guards that had guarded her in the concentration camp, she goes to them and she releases forgiveness. Suffering from the loss of her father, her sister, she continued to go and bring hope and forgiveness. 40 years later, Peter is trying to make sense out of things we get stuck in. 40 years later, Peter is going through Israel and he suffers a major heart attack. They race him to the hospital. They can't get him home in time to save him. And there's a cardiologist is about to operate on him. The cardiologist says to him, "Are you at any chance related to the Ten Booms of Holland?" Corrie Ten Boom being the family name. And he looked at him and said, "Yes, I am. They are my family." And the doctor said to him, "I am one of the babies your family saved 40 years ago." We find ourselves stuck in situations that don't make sense. None of us, I don't assume, will end up in prison or will end up in a concentration camp, but we find ourselves stuck in situations and we don't understand God's plan or God's purpose. And so we're going to look at the life of Joseph very briefly here this morning, how he faced detours and how he found himself stuck in places he didn't want to be in, and to see what happens in his life. We first read about Joseph in Genesis 37, way up the beginning of the Bible, round about 1700-1800 BC. He's now, he's age 17. Matter of fact, if you took it between Genesis 37 and 50, depending on how fast you read, you could read his entire story from 17 years of age to when he died at 110 in probably about 10 to 15 minutes. That's sometimes the hard part as we open up the Bible and we allow the different men and women in here to mentor us. We read their story and we see the end of their story, but oftentimes we can't see the end of our story when we're stuck. If you go to a cemetery today, you would see on a tombstone someone's birth date and the date they left the earth. And in the middle, there's this dash. There's a birth date, dash, and end date. And that dash is where we live our lives. That dash sums up nearly the entirety of our lives. Joseph was the youngest of 11 brothers. His father's name was Jacob. And later on, it gets changed to Israel. He would have another brother born during his life in Egypt, Benjamin. It says his father loved him more than all of his brothers. And so fathers here this morning, there's a warning sign for us not to love one over the other, because it created massive problems in this story. It says his father loved him more than all of the other brothers, and so he showed him partiality and favoritism. He gives him a cloak. When I was in Sunday school, we call it the cloak of many colors. It was probably actually a tunic. But that tunic, that coat that his father gave to him, really was supposed to go to the eldest brother. And it meant the eldest. It meant honor. It meant the oldest one, the one who wore that coat, would get a double inheritance in the will. His brothers hate him. They despise him. They're jealous of him. Joseph has dreams, and not only many of us dream, but Joseph was able to interpret his dreams, which is fantastic, which is going to be great for later on in the story, but not now. And so he tells his brothers, this is what you're going to do. And it causes them to hate him even more. And his brothers can't forgive him. They want to kill him, but wiser thinking prevails. So they betray him and they throw him into a pit. And then along come some slave traders and they buy him and they take him off to Egypt. It's interesting, in the 10 or 15 minutes you read it, when you go to the end of Joseph's life, we're now talking over 20 years later, when his brothers come to him and appear before him, Joseph said to his brothers, "Don't be afraid of me. Am I God to judge and punish you? As far as I am concerned, God turned into good what you meant for evil. He brought me to this high position I have today." Joseph was brought to second in charge of all of Egypt, so I could save the lives of many people. Joseph said, "What you meant for evil, the places I found myself stuck in because of you, God turned it and meant it for good." It's hard for us to see that when we go through things we don't understand, that God is able to turn for our good and work something of good in us as we follow him. So Joseph, at the end of his life, looks back and sees all the places he was stuck in, the many years he was stuck, and saw that God had a purpose and a plan. God brought me to this position, second in charge. How did he get there? He's 17, he's in a field looking after his father's flocks. When his brothers take him, throw him in a pit, and he's sold to traders who took him to Egypt. It's interesting, just keep that in the back of your mind. He goes from a pit to slave traders. He's sold into Potiphar's house, who was a worked for Pharaoh. He's falsely accused, so he's stuck. He should have been executed when he's falsely accused of sexually abusing Potiphar's wife. And then he finds himself in prison, stuck, the last place he wanted to be. He finds himself stuck in prison for years. He has promises made to him in prison, but nothing happens. He's forgotten about until Pharaoh has a dream. Joseph interprets it, and then Joseph's put into position as second in charge, and he saves two nations. He saves the nation of Egypt, and he saves the nation of Israel. In Genesis 37, 28, it says, Ishmaelite slave traders took him along to Egypt and sold him to Potiphar. Egypt was God's plan and purpose for him all the way along. Why didn't God just take him in a straight line, go to Egypt, do not pass go, do not collect $200, just go straight to Egypt? Why allow him to be detoured and to be stuck along the way? Detours are often unplanned and often unexpected shifts in the route we were taking to get us to where we were trying to go. We don't like them. It bugs me if I'm driving from here to my house, as they were the other day, and they've put a detour in. I'm thinking, what? It's inconvenient. Why didn't you message me on a good a different way? We don't like them. They're frustrating. They often can be times of great disappointment. They can be discouraging. They take us way off course. They take us a lot longer to get to our destination than we had planned. 2 years ago, Judith and I, after Good Morning Friday service, were going up to see my mum, and it took us 5.5 hours because we had detours all the way. Hey, this last Good Friday, it took us just over 2 hours. How great was that? We're stuck where we don't want to be. Nothing makes sense. But God has a plan and a purpose for all of us through the situations in life we find ourselves stuck in. Number one, His first plan is that you and I would know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We just celebrated that last Easter. Second is that you would know ultimately that when you leave this earth, that where you're going to. Because Jesus said in John 14, there's no way to the Father. I am the way, the truth, the life. There is no way to heaven. There is no way to the God the Father except through me. His plan and purpose for all of us. That's why He created us. First was to know Him as Savior. Second, to know where we're going. And third, as followers of Jesus Christ. He has a plan and a purpose for us to fulfill here on earth. He hasn't just called us just to sit in church. He has things and plans and purposes for us to do. And God can use the detours, the places we find ourselves stuck in, to prepare us, to develop something in us, to do a character change in us, to fulfill His destiny for our lives. I guess the problem that we face as humans is that sometimes we never recover from the detours. We remain stuck. Our detours become dead ends. But they don't have to be dead ends, places where we're stuck in. God does have a plan and the ability to be able to use them. The question is, will I let Him? Will we let Him? Do we want to get out of the pit, or would you rather stay stuck? Will we let the stuck places become a detour and not a dead end? Joseph's detours ended him up in a pit and a prison. But God was doing a work on his heart, on his character. We could look at Joseph and probably say he was a bit full of himself. He's telling his brothers, you're all going to bow down to me, and this is going to happen, and that's going to happen, which is all true, but sometimes maturity says we just keep our mouth shut. In a sense, he was a bit full of himself. It says in Genesis 37 that he went and ratted on his brothers to his father. He said to his father, do you know what your sons are doing? He wore a coat when he knew it should have been for Reuben, his oldest brother. He told his brothers, you will bow down, true, but for God to use him to save two nations, he had to do a work in him. He had to do a change in him. Joseph would go from 17 another 20 odd years more before it all made sense, before God's purposes came to him. God was at work in his heart. The psalmist says to us in Psalm 105, he sent someone to Egypt ahead of them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. There in prison, they bruised his feet. They placed his neck in an iron collar until the time came to fulfill his word. The Lord tested his character. Then Pharaoh sent for him and set him free. The ruler of the nation opened his prison door. Joseph was put in charge of all the king's household. He became a ruler over all the king's possessions. The detours in Joseph's life, the places he found himself stuck in, made no sense. But God was preparing a destiny for him. God has a purpose for you. What happens when we get stuck? When life doesn't make sense, do we run to God or do we try and fix it ourselves? What do we do? What are our emotions? What are our reactions? How would you feel if you were Joseph? Maybe you've been wronged here today. Maybe you've been stuck in places. How would you feel if you were Joseph? If you've been robbed, wronged, would you look for revenge? Joseph could have. We don't read all the details of his life, but I wonder if Joseph had a list of names tucked away in his back pocket. That one day, when I become second in charge, I'm going to pull that list out and I'm going to look for revenge. The first on his list would have been his brothers. And he will face them many years later. The second on his list would probably be the slave traders. And then Potiphar's wife that falsely accused him. We all have people in our lives that we want to blame, even when they've wronged us. The last one would be the cupbearer. Joseph's thrown into prison. And in prison is Pharaoh's cupbearer and Pharaoh's baker. Both of them have dreams. Joseph says, one of you will live, one of you will die. But then he says to him, but whenever, which one's released? When you get released, talk to Pharaoh about me. I shouldn't be in here. I've done nothing wrong. When you get released, remember me to Pharaoh. The cupbearer is released. And he forgets. He says nothing. Joseph now spends another 2 years in prison. Do you have a list? Maybe not a written list, but we have a list somewhere tucked in our mind on those who have wronged us, those who have betrayed us, those who have treated us unfairly. And we get stuck in our thinking, in our responses. We get stuck in our attitudes of stubbornness. When things don't make sense, hurts, disappointments, discouraged, how do we respond? Joseph had every reason to feel betrayed. He had every reason to not release forgiveness. He had every reason to be resentful. But if he had of, he would have stayed stuck and never fulfilled God's purpose and destiny for his life. Betrayed. One of the subjects, betrayal, that we talk to our younger leaders about because they don't learn about it in Bible college. There's times in your life where you're in leadership or work, whatever it is, that you may or you will be betrayed. And it doesn't mean that we just have to forgive everyone and get on with it, it's that we do offer forgiveness, but then there's times we don't trust that person again in our lives and we stay at a distance. God was betrayed. Joseph, as we see, David was betrayed by his best friend. Jesus was betrayed by Judas, ultimately betrayed by all his disciples. Betrayal often happens, is inevitable. But what is not inevitable and what we can never allow into our life is bitterness, revenge, or resentment. And they're the very things that try and attach us. Imagine Joseph sitting there in prison. He's been betrayed, and the very things that want to grab a hold of him and keep him stuck is bitterness, revengeful, resentment. But if we allow them in, they will kill us like a cancer. Joseph had to let them go. Unforgiveness. Corrie ten Boom gives this quote, "Forgiveness is the key that unlocks the door of resentment and the handcuffs of hatred. It is a power that breaks the chains of bitterness and the shackles of selfishness. Resentment. Nelson Mandela. This is something we should have written on all our walls. Resentment is like drinking poison and then hoping it will kill your enemies or kill somebody else. God was working on Joseph's character while he was tucked away. We don't know what he was thinking, but we do know this. Three times it'll tell you in Genesis that God was with him. God is with you. That's the whole message of Christmas. God, Emmanuel, God came to us. God is with us. God is for us. God is for you. He's not aloof. And you're able to go to him for help at any time. The book of Hebrews says, because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, that we just remembered last weekend, that you and I have 24/7. We're able to come access to God the Father. We don't have to go through anybody else. It says that we can come boldly before the throne of grace. And there we can obtain mercy. Mercy is we don't get what we deserved. There we are able to find grace to help in our time of need in the places we get stuck. We all at times get stuck, but will we ask for help? God, what do you want to say to me as I open up your book? What do you want to change in me? What are you asking me to do? Help me to trust you when life does not make sense, because we were never meant to understand everything that happens, because if we did, we'd be God. So there's things we walk through that we have to put our faith and trust in him. All of us have faith. You have faith when you came in this morning that seat would hold you up. None of you looked to see whether it would. You have faith tomorrow when you hop on a train that train will get you to the destination. We can't say planes because you can hardly fly anywhere. It's just about trust. Did you notice Jed up here this morning? Jed wasn't looking down at the floor thinking, that's a long way to fall if they drop me. He just sat there because he trusted that Jam would just hold him. And so that's the same. We're trusting God to hold us. He says, I created you, I cared for you, and I carry you. And we remind ourselves, just three brief scriptures I'm going to give you as we close this morning, if the worship team would come. Psalm 32:8-9 says this, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise and watch over you. I have a good pathway for my life planned out. It's not about other people's pathway for you or even your own pathway. God says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. That will mean that we will walk through good times and we will walk through bad times, but in everything we walk through, God says, I'm going to guide you along the best pathway for your life. Proverbs 20:24 says, how can we understand the road we travel? We don't understand everything that happens, but it is the Lord, as we trust him, as we follow him, who directs our steps as we follow him. The third one is this. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Isn't it interesting that God created you with wisdom? He created you with skills. He created you with talents. He created you with gifts. He created you with understanding. But then the writer here to the Proverbs says, even though you're brilliant, you're bright, you're skillful, you're gifted, don't rely on that. Use it, but don't rely on it. It says, rely on him. In all your ways, do not lean on your own understanding, but acknowledge him, lean on him. We've been created. And so we open up this book and we allow it to speak to us. We allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. We allow the people in this book to mentor us and lead us through the detours and through the places we get stuck so that we don't stay there. We stay accountable. Maybe you need a counselor today to go see. Maybe you need another man or another woman. You need advice, because all of us have blind spots and we don't see where we get stuck. And so we need someone else who loves us, as a friend with us, who walks with us, and is able to help us get unstuck. And then lastly, we just guard our hearts. We guard our hearts, for out of our heart flows all the issues of life. Let's stand this morning. God has a plan and ability to be able to use the detours in your life and in my life and the places we get stuck in. The question is, will we let Him? Will we let Him? Or we just say, I'm able to do it myself. Let me ask you a question. Where are you stuck today? Father, as we come before You, as we end this service this morning, all of us find places that we get stuck. And we ask for Your help as we acknowledge that. We ask for the help of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, we ask for Your help as we build our lives on You, that You will help us to not allow the detours of the places we're stuck in to cause us to remain there. We thank You for the life of Joseph, who refused with betrayal and resentment and everything, unforgiveness, everything that happened in his life. He refused to allow himself to be stuck there as You worked on his heart and on his character. So today, Lord, we open up our hearts to You. We open up our hearts to You. And we ask for help. Whether it's through just praying, opening Your word, whether it's through going to a counselor, whether it's meeting with another brother and sister, we ask for help so that we don't remain stuck, because we know that as we follow You, You want us to move on. You want us to go on. You don't want us to keep going back over the same things we've got. You want us to lead us forward. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank You, Lord.